You're listening to the audio production of Life Behind the Wall by Robert Elmer, published by Zondervan and read by McKenzie Fetters. Candy Bombers by Robert Elmer.
Prologue. Bighorn County Airport, Grable, Wyoming, April 1988. Nick held Trouble's collar and scanned the runway on the other side of the chain-link fence, just to be sure. From here, the Bighorn County Airport looked tons bigger than any old Wyoming airstrip, maybe because it had started out as a military base in the 1940s before it became a home for smoke-jumping and forest firefighting planes. It stretched way out past Little Dry Creek, like a big city airport, only Grable was no big city. He counted a dozen bright orange planes parked around the oversized hangars. They used those planes during fire season, not April, and not on a Saturday morning, when the mechanics and everybody else were probably sleeping in. Then he squinted at the five old cargo planes, their aluminum skins glimmering in the first rays of morning sun. The one on the end was the coolest, a mothballed four-engine C-54 Skymaster transport with a silly flying baby painted on its side. The Berlin Baby. Funny name for a plane. But all the planes still wore their stars proudly, even though the years of blistering seasons in Wyoming had faded the old girls. Come on, Trouble. He crouched as low as he could and sprinted to the shadow of the C-54's wings. He waited for a moment to make sure nobody saw them. Okay. In one smooth move, Nick pulled himself up the rope ladder and swung inside the open hatch of the big Skymaster. Trouble barked as soon as he disappeared, the way she always did, as in, "Don't forget me!" "Shh!" Nick tried to quiet her down as he added his pack to his book stash. He took in a whiff of air, still smelling of clouds, with a hint of airplane fuel. Just right. And that was probably the best part about this place. The smells and the wondering and the dreaming. How many times had she been around the world? And how many miles had slipped under her wings? What kinds of cargoes had filled her huge dark insides, now littered with ripped nets, ropes, and lumpy canvas tarps? And who had flown her during the past 40 years, before Nick had secretly taken over command? Next came Trouble. Nick reached down to the clothesline still knotted to his belt. He had tied the other end around his little mutt's body like a harness, and it was no trouble to hoist his cargo into the plane with him. The dog had done this dozens of times. So, once inside, Trouble curled up in her usual spot behind the co-pilot's chair, while Nick secured the hatch and settled into the pilot's seat. He imagined that his view of the distant, snow-capped Bighorn Mountains to the east might look almost the same if they were airborne. Let's take it up 32,000. Throttle up. Heading 089er. Trouble glanced up and wagged her tail, thunk-thunking the plane's metal skin. At the same time, a much louder thunk nearly lifted Nick out of his seat. Hey, you in there! Bam, bam, bam. Out! Get out! The hair on the back of Trouble's neck stiffened, and she tilted her head at the noise. But with Nick's hand on her collar, she didn't bark. Good girl, he whispered. Do you hear me? Came the foghorn voice again. Bam, bam, bam. Get out of here. I'm going to call the sheriff and have you arrested for trespassing. He would, too. Nick had heard the stories about the caretaker. So, like a pilot with a pre-flight checklist, Nick ticked off his options. Option one. Surrender and come out. Pray for mercy. Maybe not. Option two, sit right there and say nothing. But the first place the sheriff would look for him was right there, which left him with option three, hide in the cargo hold. Really hide. Don't make me wait all day, kid. I know you're in one of these planes. Aha! One of these planes? If the old guy wasn't sure which one, Nick knew he still had a chance of not being discovered. So he slipped off his shoes, picked up Trouble, and tiptoed into the shadowy belly of the airplane. The flashlight gave him a wimpy little flicker, but it still had just enough juice to guide him back past the navigator's table to the cargo hold. But where to hide? He crawled to the line of wooden crew seats, wedged himself below one, covered himself up with a piece of canvas, and waited. Come on, kid! The voice sounded a little softer this time. Moving away. Nick lay back in his hiding place with the bottom of a fold-down wooden seat just inches from his face. And he noticed something. What's that? He pointed the light up to check it out. Somebody had carved a name into the bottom of the seat. Well, that was rude. But kids did that to old school desks all the time. Was it really a name, though? Maybe, if you could see past the little stain, which looked like old dried blood. First came a capital E, then an R, except it was squiggly and hard to make out. Erich something? The rest of the words didn't look English. What kind of weird graffiti was that for an old Air Force cargo plane? Kapitel 1. Berlin, Germany. Summer 1948, 40 years earlier. Erich stopped his carving for a minute, listening to everything going on outside the plane. So far, his plan was going almost the way he'd hoped. Step 1. Sneak onto the American plane that was unloading supplies at Berlin's Tempelhof Airport. That had been no problem with all the confusion of the airlift, with hundreds of planes coming and going all day and night. In fact, the British and the Americans had been flying in for weeks, ever since the Russians had blocked off Berlin, surrounding it so no supplies could come in or go out by land. Step 2. Find a stash of food. Maybe some dried fruit or flour. A few potatoes. Whatever. The Americans would never miss it. They weren't doing this because they cared about the people of Berlin. Nein. No, Erich was sure of it. It was just part of their war, this cold war they fought, the English and the Americans and the French, against the Russians. Step 3. Slip away without getting captured by the enemy. And if he could pull this off, everyone back in the neighborhood would call him a hero. Erich the hero. He liked the sound of that. See? The World War might have been over for 3 years, but 13-year-olds could still do risky and important things. But this plane held no food, nothing. So he decided he'd just leave some kind of record behind. Proof that he'd been here, that he'd been brave enough to do what he'd told everyone he would. Maybe his cousin Katerina and the others would never see it, but he would know, and that would be enough. Keeping one eye on the exit, just in case, he crouched low and used the dull point of his penknife to carve a few words into the bottom of the wooden seat. And no, he didn't feel guilty or like a vandal, though Katerina would have yelled at him. After all, this airplane belonged to the enemy. Even though the war had ended, the men who flew this plane had rained fire and death on his city, and on his family, and on his father. Yes, Erich Becker was here to try to even the score, any way he could, even when the knife slipped and jabbed his finger. Ouch! Forget the trickle of blood. He continued for a couple more minutes until he had finished. There. He folded up his knife, crawled to the exit door, and looked around. All clear? He slipped out and landed like a cat on the hard-packed airport runway. Safe for now. Erich adjusted his cap down lower and wished for a few more shadows so he could blend into the German work crews, men who swarmed over each incoming plane to pick it clean of cargo. No one seemed to notice when he hurried along with everyone else. A truck screeched by him, full of men on their way to unload an approaching C-54. Its pilot followed close behind a guide jeep bearing a big "Follow Me" sign. If nothing else, the Americans knew how to run an airport. "Let's go, gentlemen!" A man in uniform windmilled his right arm at the approaching truck, pointing to a place on the pavement where he wanted the work crew to wait. Another man wearing dark green coveralls and white gloves stood at attention in front of the plane parade, directing the latest arrival with twirling hand motions. The plane taxied into position. Its four propellers spun down, and the side hatch popped open, all at once. Erich tried not to stare at the finely tuned ballet, where each dancer knew just when to jump, and how high. Instead, he studied the pavement and held onto his hat as a final gust of propeller backwash hit him, hunched his shoulders, and did his best to look 10 years older and 6 inches taller. Only, which plane would have food in it? Which could he try next? Not the one at the end of the lineup, where the crew raced to unload bin after bin of coal. He skirted around that one while still trying to look as if he were going somewhere on purpose. And that might have worked fine, if he hadn't rounded the next plane and run square into a brown uniformed soldier. "Bitte, bitte." Erich choked out an apology as he caught his balance. "Excuse me." But that wasn't enough for the soldier, who grabbed Erich by the shirt sleeve and waved a friend over to join them. "Bitte, bitte, nothing." The soldier scowled and didn't loosen his grip. "You can't be wandering around here. Which crew are you with, anyway?" Erich tried to back away, couldn't, and decided the safest answer would be rapid-fire German. He was going over to the Flughafen, headquarters, just as ordered, he said, in a terrible hurry. Schnell! But the soldier only held up his free hand, motioning for him to stop. Whoa, whoa! Around here we speak English, fella. Verstehen? Understand? He looked a little closer, and his eyes widened. Hey, wait a minute. This time, Erich did everything he could to wiggle away, twist out of the grip. But the more he tried to flee, the tighter the man squeezed his arm. Hey, Andy! That must have been his friend, now trotting over to join them. Look at this! This ain't no worker! I just caught me a street kid! How do you think he snuck in here? Erich knew he was dead. Take him back to the Kirchhof, the graveyard next to the airport, and bury him. Beats me, answered Andy, a dark-skinned man wearing dark green coveralls and a baseball cap with the bill turned up in front. But you better get him out of here before the captain finds out, or we're going to have some explaining to do. Yeah. The first man frowned again and began to drag Erich toward the main terminal building. You speak English, kid? Erich wasn't sure he should answer yes, but he couldn't help staring at the dark soldier as he stumbled away from the airplanes. He'd seen black men before a couple of times, mostly Africans, but only from a distance. Never this close up. Erich had to focus his ears to understand what this man was saying. The edges of his words sounded as if they'd been rounded off, and Erich liked the smooth warmth of them. What's the matter, kid? Andy flashed him a smile. You look like a deer caught in the headlights. Erich swallowed hard and nodded, not sure how a deer could find itself in such a place, or he in this one. Out this way. The first guy pointed at a gate in the fence where trucks and jeeps came and went past one of the airport's main terminal buildings. And don't you ever let me catch you trying to sneak in here again, you hear? I hear. Erich finally managed a couple of words, which made the man named Andy laugh. You probably understand every word we've been saying, huh? Not every word. Erich shook his head as he hurried out the gate, rubbing his arm where he'd been squeezed by the first guy. But Andy called after him. Hey, wait a minute. Erich didn't wait. You like Hershey bars? Asked Andy. Erich froze, but wasn't sure if he should turn around. It was a trick. Had to be. Hershey's? The man repeated. You know, chocolate? That did it. Erich looked over his shoulder, just to be sure. The tall man reached out, offering a brown-wrapped candy bar. Erich couldn't ever remember having a Hershey bar all to himself. A bite, once. Never a whole bar. His stomach danced at the thought. Come on, said Andy. Take it before I change my mind. You've got to be hungry, right? Erich could already taste the chocolate, sweet and warm and rich. He turned back to accept the gift, expecting the man to pull it away at the last second. But no. Dankeschön. Erich looked up at the man whose skin seemed as dark as the chocolate he offered. Thank you. Andy! Someone yelled from inside the Flughafen. Need you back here! See you around. The man winked at him as he turned to go. Only next time, you stay outside the fence, okay? Andy? The voice did not belong to a patient man. Aren't you going to eat it, kid? Andy asked as he started back through the main gate. I thought everybody liked chocolate. Yeah. Erich fingered the treasure, knowing how wonderful it would taste. It had been given to him, had it not? Didn't he have every right to enjoy it? He paused. Yes, but it will be for Oma, grandmother. And before he could change his mind, he slipped the precious Hershey bar into his shirt pocket, turned, and sprinted away. Kapitel 2. Good excuse. I told you, I didn't steal it. Erich pedaled up the Potsdamer Straße, Potsdamer Street, as fast as his old bike would let him. I can't believe you would even think that of me. Sure. Katharina checked over her shoulder and slowed down as they entered the spooky wasteland of the Tiergarten, once a beautiful, green city park, but now sheared of all its trees by bombs and firewood scavengers. Some of the grand statues still stood, headless, high on their columns, ruling over rubble and ruins. Others had long since toppled to the gravel pathway. But I don't think your story is going to help us explain what took us so long to get home. We'll just tell them the truth. A big, green lizard monster grabbed me and wouldn't let go. I was kidnapped. Katharina wasn't buying it. Okay, then how about a big American soldier in a brown uniform? And then are you going to explain why he stopped you? Well, Katerina led the way on a rusty old bike with warped wheels and a chain that fell off every other block, which was actually fine.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.